Thank you. Very good. Thank you and welcome. Welcome to the Mike Lazaridis Theater of Ideas here at Perimeter Institute for Theoretical Physics in Waterloo, Ontario, Canada. And welcome to this Perimeter's public lecture series. My name is Greg Dick. I'm the Director of Educational Outreach here at Perimeter, and it is a pleasure to welcome everyone here this evening, both those of you here in the live studio audience and those of you watching online, whether on Perimeter's website or on one of our many science communication websites around the globe. The lecture itself will last approximately 1 hour and will be followed by a question and answer session. For those of you watching online, Dr. Stephanie Keating and a team of PI researchers are following the Facebook and Twitter feeds, ready to engage in conversation throughout the lecture. If you want to participate there, please use hashtag PILive. And I will also take a question or two from those online feeds during the question and answer session. And now, it is my pleasure to introduce tonight's very special guest speaker, Dr. Mario Livio. Dr. Livio is an internationally known astrophysicist and best-selling author who has worked for 24 years for the Hubble Space Telescope. Dr. Livio is distinguished in his research and has published over 400 publications and scientific papers, ranging in topics from dark energy and cosmology to black holes and extrasolar planets. And he has received numerous awards for his research, including having been selected the Carnegie Centenary Professor by the University of Scotland and the Dance Distinguished Lecturer by the University of Washington. He is also a fellow of the American Association for the Advancement of Science. Dr. Livio may be best known as an author of 5 popular books, popular science books. He has received the Beno Prize and the International Pythagoras Prize for his book, The Golden Ratio. Not only is he a best-selling author and a gifted academic, but he is also passionate about art and science and the intersection of art and science. And as such, he is the science advisor to the Baltimore Symphony Orchestra. Tonight, Dr. Livio will discuss his most recent book, Brilliant Blunders, which appeared on the New York bestsellers list and was selected by the Washington Post as one of 2013's best books of the year. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome to the stage with his talk, Brilliant Blunders, Dr. Mario Livio.
Thank you very much. It's a pleasure to be here. I should warn you that I have ADHD, so I walk a lot. I cannot stand in one place. Why blunders? As I was writing this book, my colleagues, and it took almost 4 years, my colleagues kept asking me, what is your book about? And I used to say, it's about blunders, and it's not an autobiography. I would give you one simple reason why I decided to write a book about blunders now, but I will give you the more serious reason towards the end of the talk. The simple reason is that it is kind of comforting to the rest of us to know that even the greatest luminaries made some serious mistakes. In this book, I've chosen actually 5 people. I'm only going to talk about 3 today. The 5 people that I've chosen are Charles Darwin, Lord Kelvin, Linus Pauling, Fred Hoyle, and Albert Einstein. Most of these names are probably familiar to most or all of you. Maybe Fred Hoyle is a bit less familiar in this country, but he was one of the greatest astrophysicists of the 20th century, and certainly it was extremely well known in the UK. There are a few things that guided my thinking in terms of the people I chose and what I decided to do. So the first thing I should note is I only chose to discuss one blunder for each person, rather than making, you know, a laundry list of all the possible mistakes that everyone has made. I should also say that in my choice of these people, I decided not to go too far back, in the sense that, you see, suppose I look at Aristotle. Essentially, everything that Aristotle said in physics is wrong. Now, that doesn't make him any less of a genius than what he was. It just, you know, worked against a different background. So I only went back to the middle of the 19th century. There is also something that guided my choice of these five people. And that is the concept of evolution. And by that I mean evolution of life on Earth, evolution of the Earth itself, evolution of stars, and evolution of the universe as a whole. So the concept of evolution runs through all my people here. So now let me start. The first thing you notice about life on Earth is how diverse it is. It's enough, you know, to go outside here now, and you're gonna see lots of plants, insects, some people walking their dogs, birds fly, and so on. Nobody actually even knows precisely how many species there are on Earth. The latest very serious attempt to actually put a number on that came up with something like 8.7 million species. But numbers range all the way from 5 to about 100 million. And it's easy to see why there is such a large uncertainty, because number one, you know, every year they discovered new and new and new species. And plus, you know, you have to realize it's enough to take a teaspoon of dirt from under your feet, and there already are thousands of species in there. So we don't know how many, but we know that it's a very, very large number. The second thing we notice about life on Earth is an incredible degree of adaptation, and also this kind of scratch my back and I'll scratch yours type relationship, which we like to call symbiosis. You know, you look at the bee, and the bee has precisely the size that it fits into the flowers on which it feeds, and then the pollen gets on the bee's legs and body, and she moves it to the other flower and all that and so on. This clownfish that I have here, you know, it lives among the poisonous tentacles of this sea anemone. The fish protects the anemone protects the fish. The fish has this special mucus on its body that protects it against the poison of its host. So all of this, you know, this kind of very, very symbiotic relation. Now, these two facts, the enormous diversity and the incredible degree of adaptation, convinced many, many naturalists over centuries that there has to be some guiding hand and I don't know what, you know, and things like that. All of that changed when this gentleman here published in 1859 this book on the origin of species by means of natural selection. This is, of course, Charles Darwin. Here he is when he was older. By the way, just as an aside, when I write my books, I like to go to the places where the people actually worked. And so I actually did hold in my hand the first copy of Darwin's book. And I can tell you, you know, for a generation that maybe grew up with seeing everything on computer screens, that for me, it's still a special feeling to hold that book in my hand. I know it's not for everybody. I've put this slide here not because it is correct, which it isn't, but because it's very pretty from a graphics design perspective. It is supposed to describe evolution, and I think you will agree with me that it's a very pretty slide. The reason I say it's not correct is that when you look at a slide like this, you get the impression that things here are more evolved, perhaps, than things here. And that's not the case. I mean, evolution doesn't work like a ladder. It works more like a bush. Namely, things evolve in different directions. But things that are equidistant from the origin are equally evolved. So that's how this thing goes. There is one thing that Darwin didn't like to publish, and that was genealogy trees. He never published one. But in his own notebooks, and I held those in my hand, he actually did draw some of those in order to guide his thoughts. I like very much this one because, look, it has primates down here and men up there. So he did do such things for himself, but he never published them. Now, what is this theory of evolution that Darwin came up with? The theory of evolution has four pillars, four major pillars, and those four major pillars are supported by one grand mechanism. Now, this figure here has nothing to do with Darwin's theory of evolution. It comes from a Hindu myth. But you see, it has four pillars, and they are supported by one grand mechanism, so I thought it fits here. There is, by the way, a story that is almost certainly not true. I could never find out that it was actually true. But it is such a good story that I will tell you the story nonetheless. I mean, there is a proverb in Italian, some of you may know, "Se non è vero, è ben trovato," which basically says, even if it's not true, it's a good story. So I'm going to tell you that story. And the story is that Bertrand Russell, the famous mathematician and philosopher, once gave a talk, and he had a drawing something like this. And there was some woman in the audience who asked, "But Mr. Russell, on what does that giant turtle stand?" And he said, "On another giant turtle." And they said, "On what does that turtle stand?" And he says, "Yet another giant turtle." And the woman insisted, "On what does that giant turtle stand?" And he says, "Lady, I'm afraid from there it's turtles all the way down." Now, this almost certainly never happened, but it's a very good story. Now, what are these four pillars? First, there is the pillar of evolution itself. Namely, Darwin tells us, the species are not immutable. The species we see today are not the species that always existed. In fact, most of the species that existed on Earth have become extinct. Today only we see the species that evolved from those that existed previously. That's the first concept. And it's, of course, a crucial one. The second is gradualism. Darwin borrowed this from his geologist friends, in particular Charles Lyell, was the greatest geologist at the time, and he was a personal friend of Darwin. And the idea was the following. Darwin says, you know, it's not that you're going to sit there, watch a species, and turn, we'll see it turn into another species. Things are very, very slow. Just like on the surface of the Earth, the sun and the wind and the rain, you know, very slowly changes the surface. That's how changes happen. You have to wait tens or sometimes hundreds of thousands of generations to see a change. The third is common descent. This is a powerful concept. It says, Darwin says, all these species that you see today, they all started from one life form. This is an enormous concept. And this concept is actually at the basis of all the origin of life experiment. You know, I have a personal friend, Jack Szostak at Harvard. He works on origin of life. He keeps telling me that within 5 years or so, he will actually get life in the lab from chemistry. So, you know, the fact that we think there is a common descent, that's what allows us to even think in those terms. And finally, there is speciation. Speciation is, you know, you can say, okay, if all life started from one form, how come we have so many species today? And there Darwin says, well, because we have branching or splitting. And he drew this diagram in his notebook. This, you know, this is again a diagram where, so basically what happens, you have certain species, it splits into two others, that one splits into two others, and so on. And since at every such node, you basically double the number of species, very quickly you get to very large numbers. Again, I like very much this page, because he writes here at the top, "I think," you know. So Darwin was very, very humble at that stage of his life. Now, as I said, these four pillars are supported by one grand mechanism, and that grand mechanism is natural selection. There is a philosopher at Tufts, Daniel Dennett, who wrote once that he thought that evolution by means of natural selection, that is the greatest single idea that anybody has ever had. You know, maybe it's a bit of an exaggeration, but it certainly is a fantastic idea. And like all of the great ideas, you know, it sounds simple once it's pointed out to you. And the idea is the following. What does natural selection tell us? It tells us, look, suppose you have certain members of a species. And suppose that some members of that species have a certain characteristic that gives them an advantage. An advantage both in terms of coping with their environment, with predators, I don't know what, so that, and also in terms of the production of offspring. Very important. Then, Darwin tells us, over many, many generations, the entire population is going to shift towards that characteristic. You understand this, right? I mean, if that gives you an advantage and you also produce more offspring, then over many, many generations, you shift everything towards that. That's the idea. Now, how does it actually work? Let's see a few very simple examples. So, in England of the 19th century, there was this white, light-colored peppered moth. And originally, it was so well camouflaged, look, you can barely see it here. You see, you can hardly even notice that it's there. But then, you know, 1848 was the Industrial Revolution. They started pouring enormous amounts of soot into the atmosphere, blackened all the trees, and this light-colored peppered moth started sticking out like a sore thumb. So it became the target for massive predation, to the point that it became almost entirely extinct. At the same time, by the way, the melanic version, the dark version of this moth, of course, started thriving because, you know, it was better camouflaged at this point. Luckily for the light-colored peppered moth, even in England of the 19th century, they adopted somewhat greener practices, and this moth was actually saved from complete extinction. These pictures here just show very red snakes that evolved so that they adapt to their surroundings, you know, and so on in terms of color and this. Now, where do we actually see natural selection the most today? With bacteria. Why? Because bacteria, the populations are humongous, and they multiply very fast. So the entire evolution process is compressed for them. And what does that do? I'm sure you just heard, actually, a case has been now found in the US just last week of bacteria that are resistant to all forms of antibiotics. Every year, actually, in the US, you have something like 23,000 people who die because they are infected by bacteria that are resistant to most antibiotics. I mean, this case that they found last week is resistant even to this rare antibiotic that they hardly ever use because it had such severe side effects, you know, and so on. But this is what happens. Now, they always try to present it to you as if we are to blame. And we are to some extent, in the sense that if the doctor prescribes to you antibiotics and says, she says you should take it for 10 days, you feel better after 3 and you stop taking it. That's not good. That's how resistant bacteria are. But that's not the main cause. The main cause, of course, is that the cattle and the chicken industry, the poultry, they just feed these things enormous amounts of antibiotics. And that's how part of this is. And only about 2 years ago, they started to have some guidelines about how much antibiotics you can give these things. So anyhow, that's the situation. Now, from what I told you until now, you understand correctly that Darwin came up with a theory that explains almost everything about life on Earth. So where is the blunder? So the blunder had to do with heredity. At Darwin's time, Darwin didn't know any genetics, and we cannot blame him for that because nobody knew any genetics at the time. So Darwin adopted the theory of heredity that was the prevailing theory at the time, which was that of blending heredity, which means the characteristics of the mother and the father get blended in the offspring, just like you would mix paints. Okay? Now, again, this is not a blunder because he didn't know any better. This was the best theory available. So he adopted that. That's not a blunder. The blunder was in not understanding that if this were the correct theory of heredity, natural selection could never have worked at all. And let me explain that, okay? Suppose you have a population of a billion butterflies, and they are all white. And there is one which is black. And suppose that it is being black, that's the characteristic that gives an advantage, both in terms of coping with the environment and all that, and in terms of producing offspring, okay? According to Darwin's theory of evolution by means of natural selection, this would have meant that after many, many generations, the entire population of butterflies should turn black. Now, what happens under blending heredity? The black butterfly would mate with a white butterfly. They would produce a gray butterfly. That's, you mix like paints, okay? Notice, black has disappeared from the population, never to return again. In fact, the gray butterfly would mate with another white butterfly, and it were to produce an even paler shade of gray butterfly. Very quickly, you will have more than 50 shades of gray. But you will never see black again. You will never see black again in this population. So this was a serious, serious problem, which Darwin at first did not recognize. And it was pointed out to him by an engineer, Fleming Jenkin, who wrote a review of Darwin's book. Now, it is true that Darwin did not catch this thing, but we have lots of evidence that Darwin was unhappy with blending heredity. He didn't know how to correct it, but he was unhappy with it. First, let's see what is the difference between blending heredity and Mendelian heredity. You know, that's named after Gregor Mendel. That's the theory of heredity that we actually talk about. Let me first just say in simple terms, what Mendelian heredity is telling us is that it's not like fusing paints. It is more like shuffling cards. If you have cards, and let's say you have a jack, and having a jack is good, it doesn't matter how much you shuffle, you would still have the jack. That's the key point, okay? Unlike with paints. So here is what happens in blending heredity. In blending heredity, let's say that capital A gives you the color black, lowercase a gives you the color white, and you get from one parent to the black, from the other parent, let's say the white. Together they produce gray, that's fine. But here is the main point in blending heredity. The capital A and lowercase a cease to exist. They blend together to form something which I called A1 here, which is gray, and that's it. From now on, you will never have black. What happens in Mendelian heredity? You know, Mendel did these experiments with peas, yellow peas, green peas. He found the ratio of 3:1. From that, he concluded these laws, and that's how it works. You get capital A, lowercase a. They are black and white. They produce gray in this theory as well, gray. However, the capital A and the lowercase a continue to exist individually. And now you have two parents. One gives you capital A, lowercase a. The other one gives you capital A, lowercase a. And then depending on how you combine them, you can get black, gray, or white. And if black indeed gives you the advantage, then over many, many generations, the whole thing will turn black. That's the thing, right? Not like in blending. You know, in blending, you know, somebody gave you a gin and tonic, they will keep pouring tonic into it. At the end, you will not feel the gin. I mean, that's how it goes, right? So this is the situation. Okay. Now, I told you that Darwin was unhappy with blending heredity. How do we know that? Already in 1857, this was 2 years before he published on the origin of species, he wrote that he believes that propagation by true fertilization will turn out to be some sort of mixing and not true fusion. More like cards, not like paint. And then in 1866, he wrote to Wallace, you know, his friend and competitor at some level. He wrote something that you read this today and you say, how is it possible that nobody thought about that before? He said, look, every female of the world produces a distinct male and a distinct female, and not some intermediate hermaphrodite. So it cannot be that it is blending, you know? So he understood that blending cannot be right. He just didn't know how to correct it. And in fact, his attempt to correct it went completely the wrong way. So even though he's on the horse here, he didn't find the correct theory. Now, there are no fewer than four books that will tell you that when Darwin wrote this in 1866, it was not because he had an insight, but because he read Mendel's paper, which was published in 1865. Now, these are the kinds of things that when I write, I become obsessed about. And I decided that I absolutely have to find out whether it's possible that Darwin found out this from Mendel's paper. And luckily for me, Andrew Sclater from the Darwin Project actually did a lot of work before me, so I could rely on his work. So what did we find? We found, first of all, that in Darwin's possession, Mendel's paper does not exist. He did not have it. We have every piece of paper that was in Darwin's possession. It's not there. That's not particularly surprising. Mendel's paper was published in the annals of the Academy of Brunn, to which Darwin was not subscribed to, and it's a relatively obscure journal. Not very obscure, but relatively, so it didn't have. However, these papers will tell you that, these books will tell you that there were books in Darwin's possession which described Mendel's experiment. And it's true, there were two books in Darwin's possession which describe the experiment. Now, one of them describes the experiment so briefly that there is no way that Darwin could have understood from it anything much. The second book is this book here by one Wilhelm Olbers Focke. And again, I asked for this book to be brought to me. You see, this was Darwin's copy, even has his name up there. And do you know where Mendel's experiments are mentioned? They are mentioned exactly here, in these two uncut pages. Now, you may remember that in old books you had to cut the top. Darwin never cut the top of any page of this book. He never read this book. So Darwin did not know about Mendel's experiment. And let me tell you furthermore, I looked at the description there. Focke himself did not really understand the meaning of Mendel's experiment. So even had Darwin read that, he would not have been much illuminated. But he never read this. Now, so that's the situation. Now, by the way, Mendel was very aware of Darwin's work. Mendel had a German translation of Darwin's book. He annotated it in several places. He underlined things. On several occasions, he cited actually texts that were almost verbatim from Darwin's writing. Okay, to my next person, Linus Pauling. Linus Pauling was certainly the greatest chemist of his time. He is also the only person ever to get two Nobel Prizes without sharing them with anybody. I mean, there are a few other people who got two Nobel Prizes. Madame Curie, for example, got two Nobel Prizes. John Bardeen got two Nobel Prizes, but sharing them with others. Pauling got two Nobel Prizes without sharing them with anybody. One was for peace, but one was for chemistry. Here is Pauling at the middle age pointing to his alpha helix model for certain proteins. You know, the years passed, he became older, but the model stayed the same because it was a correct model. So that's very nice when you have a model that stays the same even though you age. In 1948, Darwin was in England. He was sick in bed, and he wanted to find the structure of certain proteins. Now, at the time, they already developed this technique of X-ray diffraction, which basically what that meant is you take a molecule that you want to determine its structure, you shine X-rays on that molecule, and from the way that those X-rays are scattered, you determine the structure of the molecule. Pauling worked exactly in the opposite way. And this was really a method that he really was his, which was, he started from structural chemistry. Namely, he wanted to know the structure of this molecule. He first wanted to know, okay, what bonds are there? What is the length of these bonds? What are the angles between certain bonds and so on? Constructed a model, and then tested the model using X-ray diffraction. So it always came to the problem from the other end. So in this particular case, he convinced himself for various reasons that the carbon, nitrogen, and the four atoms that connect to them in this molecule all have to be in one plane. And then he started folding the paper. You probably cannot see. Well, you can see the folds there, you know, where he's tried to fold the paper while keeping those atoms in one plane. And eventually, he came up with this structure, which he called the alpha helix. And he was really very, very happy with this structure. However, there was one small problem. And the problem was that in his model, the distance between two turns of the molecule was 5.4 angstroms. Angstrom is 100 millionth of a centimeter. While the X-ray diffraction images showed some signature at 5.1 angstroms. So you may think 5.4, 5.1, close enough for government work. But Pauling was unhappy. He was so unhappy that he did not publish his model for 13 years. But during those 13 years, he actually did everything he could possibly do to check his model. You know, so for example, he asks two of his group, one including Branson, to see whether there are any other solutions to the problem. And actually, Branson found another solution, which Pauling also found before, which was called the gamma helix. But it was too tight, you couldn't quite fit everything in there. So that one was rejected, but they didn't find any other solutions. He asked his assistant, Robert Corey, to do X-ray diffractions on pieces of the molecule to test everything. And after 13 years, he basically convinced himself that it has to be right. He published his model. It turned out to be the right, correct model. This discrepancy turned out to be an artifact of the fact that there is a coil inside the coil which produced an artifact at 5.1. So he was right from the beginning on this. Then he turned his attention to DNA. And on DNA, already back in 1948, I remind you that the structure of DNA was discovered in the 1950s. But already back in 1948, Pauling made the following insightful observation. He said, look, whatever the molecule it is that is responsible for replication, it can work best if it is composed of two parts that precisely complement each other. Why? Because if that's the structure, then it is enough to have half of the molecule and you already know the other half because it exactly complements it. This he said in 48, and I wish he would have remembered it later, but as you will find out, he didn't. A second thing that was known at the time was something called the Chargaff rules. This was after chemist Erwin Chargaff. And that's the following. You see, it was known already that DNA has three basic components: sugars, phosphates, and four bases, which for short were called A, T, C, and G. Okay? Now, what Chargaff discovered, that whenever he takes a piece of DNA, the number of A's is equal to the number of T's, the number of C's is equal to the number of G's. Okay? These are, you know, they have names, yes? Thymine and so on. Yeah, but A, T, C, and G. And Pauling knew about that. Now, this also seems to somehow hint at some sort of a two-side structure, you know, A equals to T, C equals to G, something like this. Yet, when Pauling finally came up with a model for DNA, it was a disastrous model. It had three strands. How do you do complementarity if you have three strands? It did not obey the Chargaff rules. It was basically built inside out, and it simply disobeyed the basic rules of chemistry. Here is what it was like.
This is Linus Pauling's failed attempt to predict the structure of DNA. The problem with his triple helix model is that the phosphates form the helical core, with the bases pointing outwards. This would be impossible under normal cellular conditions. Each phosphate group is negatively charged, and so many negative charges forced together would repel each other, literally driving the structure apart.
So he had all the phosphates in the middle. The phosphates have negative electric charges. Similar electric charges repel each other. So there was nothing to hold his structure together. In addition to the fact that it had three strands, it didn't obey any complementarity, nothing. Now, what did Pauling say about that? He said, well, yeah, they repel each other, but maybe I can hold it together with hydrogen bonds. He was the king of hydrogen bonds, so, you know, maybe I can put hydrogen atoms that will hold this together. But guess what? You know, DNA is a nucleic acid. I don't know if you remember from your high school days, I don't know, maybe they teach this in elementary school, I'm not sure. In high school day, what is an acid? An acid is something when you put it in water, it releases its hydrogen. Well, if it releases its hydrogen, then the hydrogen cannot hold it together. So basically, his model was not an acid. So his model did not obey the basic rules of chemistry, and this was the best chemist of the world. So one of the things I've done in Brilliant Blunders was to actually try to get into the minds of the people that I discussed to try to figure out why I think they made the mistakes they made. Now, this is not an easy task. First of all, I cannot interview them because they're all dead. Second, I'm not a psychologist. So, you know, even had I interviewed them, I'm not sure I would have understood exactly what the reasons are. I cannot either put them into functional MRI machines because, as I said, they are dead. But I tried to think, you know, what could it be? So I discussed this at some length for each one of them. In particular, in Pauling's case, I tried to answer three major questions. So one is, do you know how long it took Pauling to publish from when he started seriously thinking about his model from DNA till the time he published it? Remember, he published the alpha helix, it took him 13 years. You know how long it took him to publish his model for DNA, the triple helix model? It took him 1 month. So why? Why did he rush so much? Second, why the forgetfulness? What about the Chargaff rules? He seemed to have forgotten about them. His model did not obey them. And finally, what about the rules of basic chemistry? It was not an acid. There is, by the way, here, this blackboard here describes the triple helix model as one of the major blunders here. So why the rush? Well, as far as I can tell, Pauling was only human. And he was afraid that he will be scooped. He was not afraid of Watson and Crick. He barely knew of their existence. But he knew that both the group at London with Maurice Wilkins and the group at Cambridge with Lawrence Bragg had better X-ray diffraction images than he had. And he was afraid that they will publish before him. What about forgetting the Chargaff rules? I cannot quite tell that story, but I have a hunch. And that is that Pauling apparently couldn't stand Erwin Chargaff. Chargaff was a very intense individual. And Pauling was a more laid-back person. They once were together on a boat from the US to England. And every time Chargaff would catch him on the deck, he would start bothering him with his rules, you know, and so on. I almost have a feeling that Pauling tried to get out of his head anything that had to do with Chargaff. Finally, what about the basic rules of chemistry? Well, everything I told you so far showed that Pauling was only human. And the third thing makes him even more human. Pauling did not forget the basic rules of chemistry. For heaven's sake, he literally wrote the book of the rules of chemistry. What I think happened here is that he fell victim to his own previous success. You see, what lesson did he take away from the alpha helix story? The lesson he took away was that his original hunch was correct. And everything else turned out to be details that could be worked out later. He thought that his model was correct. And while he knew that it has all kinds of problems, he thought those are details. So basically, he decided to gamble, and he lost. Of course, the correct model was discovered by Watson and Crick. DNA is a double helix. The bases are inside. A connects with T, C with G, which automatically explains the Chargaff rules. It also automatically is consistent with Pauling's idea of complementarity. You know half the molecule, you know the other half. Now, what did Watson and Crick do once they discovered their model? You know, they were very young. Watson was in his 20s, Crick in his 30s. They did what every two young people would do. They went to the pub. And this is the Eagle Pub in Cambridge, where today, it's still there. It's a wonderful pub in Cambridge, if you've been there. That's Cambridge, England, yes? There is a plaque there at the place where Francis Crick stood in the middle of lunch and announced, "We discovered the secret of life." So it's a wonderful pub for many reasons. I mean, they also have a ceiling there where RAF pilots during World War II would write their names before they would leave on dangerous missions, you know, and so on, and it's still there and things like that. Now, I showed you Pauling when he was middle-aged and then old. I showed you Watson and Crick when they were young. Here it's when they're old. Of course, since then, Francis Crick unfortunately passed. Jim Watson is still very much alive, as controversial as ever, and as high-spirited as ever. I put this image here. This is from a meeting on proteins that Pauling organized in the 50s for three main reasons. The first reason is there are lots of Nobel laureates in this image. I mean, there is John Candrew, there is Maurice Wilkins, Max Perutz, Jim Watson, Francis Crick, Lawrence Bragg. This is Robert Corey, Pauling's assistant. So lots of Nobel laureates for such a small group of people. The second reason, there is only one woman, Beatrice Magdoff from the Brooklyn Polytechnic. Now, of course, things have changed. You go to a proteins meeting today, easily 50% are women. So things have changed. I should also, I mean, this talk is about Pauling, but of course I want to always emphasize Rosalind Franklin's contribution to the Watson and Crick model. I mean, without seeing her X-ray diffraction image, Watson and Crick probably could never have come up with their model. And conversely, had actually Pauling seen her X-ray diffraction image, he probably would have known it's a double helix and not a triple helix. And the third reason is a simple one. I mean, this was a science meeting. This was not a business meeting, a science meeting. Look at them. They're all wearing ties, for heaven's sake. I mean, even I'm not wearing a tie now, and hardly anybody here wears a tie. But then at science meetings, they were all wearing ties. So things have changed. My last person is Albert Einstein. This is the photo of Einstein that I like best. Partly because when my hair is a little bit longer, it looks just like that. And that's, by the way, not where the similarity ends. You see, I like to say that Newton is dead, Einstein is dead, and I also don't feel so good. Now, Einstein, of course, is best known for his theory of general relativity. This is already 2 years before he published his theory, when he tries to explain to astronomer Hale how the sun is going to bend light in his theory. But of course, the main thing is that he eventually wrote this famous equation, which I was once asked by a reporter, they were trying to make a list of the 10 most beautiful equations that exist, and I nominated this one, and it's still there on the web as my nomination for the most beautiful equation. Now, some of you may be a bit rusty on your general relativity, so I'm going to very only explain to you the principle here. So for a moment, forget about this term for a moment. What does these things do here? So this thing here describes the geometry of space-time. So it's a bit like, you know, you have a trampoline. It can bend in various ways. That's the geometry. So it has a certain geometry. This thing here describes the mass and energy content in your volume or in your universe, if you like. And this is the strength of gravity. So what does this equation say? It says that mass and energy cause space-time to bend somehow. So it's like me standing on a trampoline, I cause it to sag. And the force of gravity that comes out of this is just an expression of the curvature of the space that is formed. So a little bit like, you know, again, to continue with a trampoline, I stand on a trampoline, I cause it to warp, and then if I throw small balls onto that, they will try to find the shortest path in that warped space. So the sun warps space in its vicinity, and the planets find the shortest path in that warped space. So gravity is not some mysterious force that acts across distance. It is just an expression of this curvature of space. That is the essence of this equation. Now, as soon as Einstein wrote this equation, well, not immediately, he published this in 1915, so we celebrated last year 100 years to general relativity. In 1917, he tried to apply this equation to the universe as a whole. But when he tried to apply it to the universe as a whole, he discovered that there is a problem. And that's the following. Okay, in Einstein, in 1917, they didn't know about the existence of other galaxies other than the Milky Way. So he was talking in terms of stars. But he thought that all the stars should be fixed in their places, that the universe is static, because he thought that that is a more elegant type universe, you know, where everything is static. But, he reasoned, how can the universe be static if every little piece attracts every other little piece? Then this thing should just collapse under its own weight, basically. It cannot stay static. So what he did, he came up with this clever idea to add this term, which has in it this thing which we call the cosmological constant, which at every point in space, if you found that from gravity there was a force going this way, what that term did, it did a force exactly equal in the opposite direction, so that things will stay in equilibrium, okay? This was a clever thing, you know, that in every point, it balanced everything. Now, it was clever, but not fantastic, because even though it turns out, even though he created an equilibrium this way, it was actually an unstable equilibrium. I mean, you know, like, I can try to balance this thing on my finger, and I may even succeed, but the slightest perturbation will cause it to fall, right? So it was not in that sense. But at the time, he didn't know about that, and he thought that he had this wonderful solution, which was, you know, everything in equilibrium. However, in the late 1920s, these two gentlemen, this is the priest and cosmologist Georges Lemaître from Belgium, and this is Edwin Hubble, after whom the Hubble Space Telescope is named, discovered, and there is a whole story about that, which I describe in the book, but it's a very, very fascinating story. But they discovered that our universe is not static, it is expanding. As soon as Einstein heard that the universe is expanding, he said, wait a second, if the universe is expanding, I don't need things to be in equilibrium, because all that gravity will do, it will slow down the expansion. In the same way that, you know, I throw something up here on Earth, it's not in equilibrium, only the gravity of the Earth acts upon it, but what it does, if I gave it some speed, the gravity of the Earth simply slows it down. So the universe is expanding, gravity will slow it down. That's what he said. So in that case, he said, I don't need that extra term, and he took it out of the equation. Okay? Now, again, you will hear entire books have been written claiming that Einstein called that his biggest blunder. Again, I did a lot of research on this. I'm afraid you'll have to read the book to find out what I discovered. But in any case, he took it out. He certainly regretted having put it in, okay? Because it wasn't needed, he thought. Well, in 1998, two groups of astronomers discovered independently that the expansion of our universe is not slowing down. It's speeding up. It's speeding up. It's, you know, like, imagine I throw this up again, and not only is it not slowing down, it's speeding up towards the ceiling. You know, I once gave a talk on this accelerating universe. There was a seven-year-old who sat in the front row. And I said, what would you have said if I did this? I would throw my keys up and they would accelerate toward the ceiling. And this kid went, magic. And it is like magic, you know, it's true. I mean, basically, something has to kind of push to make this acceleration. And do you know what's that thing that pushes? As far as we can tell, although we don't know for sure yet, but everything is consistent with that the thing that pushes the universal expansion to accelerate is that term that Einstein took out of his equation. I mean, you know, some people, they are so smart that when they think they made a blunder, it turns out to be some great insight. So basically, if Einstein made a blunder at all, was not putting that term in, was taking it out. Had he not taken it out, he could have predicted that the universe should be accelerating. Okay, at this point, I've actually finished what I want to say about these three people. But I want to come back to the question of why did I decide to write a book about blunders? And here is the thing. In most textbooks, news stories, in school, and even at university, we are continuously taught as if scientific progress, and in fact, not even just scientific progress, but progress in almost any creative enterprise, is a direct march to the truth. Now, anybody who has ever been involved in scientific progress or in any creative progress knows that nothing could be further from the truth. You know, it's not, Newton didn't sit under the apple tree, an apple fell on his head, and he jumped. He said, of course, F equals GM1 M2 over R squared. It didn't happen like that. Progress in science is achieved through a zigzag path with many, many false starts, many blind alleys, many places where you need to go back to the starting point. So that's one thing I wanted to convey. But I wanted to do something more than that. You see, I called my book Brilliant Blunders, not Sloppy Blunders or something like this. What do I mean by that? There are blunders that are inexcusable. These are blunders that are made because you are sloppy. Or maybe even not quite sloppy, but not thoughtful enough. You don't think of all the possibilities. Those are inexcusable. Even blunders that are being made because you don't have the proper experience are at some level also inexcusable, because you should be aware that you are inexperienced and you should ask for the proper guidance. But at the same time, we try to encourage all our young people in particular to think what we call outside the box. Well, guess what? When you think outside the box, you may make mistakes. And those mistakes, if they are not sloppy or not thoughtful or, you know, not done by inexperienced people, they actually can lead to major breakthroughs. You know, I like mathematics very much. So, you know, if you are stuck at some minimum of the potential, you're stuck here in the middle. Sometimes, if you try to get out of this by some infinitesimal perturbation, it won't happen. You need what mathematicians call a finite amplitude perturbation to get out. And that sometimes requires something that may lead to blunders. It could happen that you will make blunders. I'll give you a few examples. In our education system, you see, we have become, I don't know if this is true in Canada or not, but in the US, people have become to rely a lot on multiple choice exams, okay? There is a lot to be said for that, because when you do multiple choice exams, they are easier to grade, and as a result, you can give more of them, which, you know, takes away the reliance of a single, you know, point failure, potentially. However, you know, in multiple choice exams, the answer is either wrong or it's correct. You never follow the thought process. There is, by the way, one private university now called Minerva, which actually tries to get away completely from multiple choice exams. Now, maybe that's too much in the other direction. But you want to every now and then find out how the students think. How many of you, I imagine many of you know about the barometer problem. Do you know about this? Does anybody know what that is? Okay, not very many know in any case. So let me tell you this story, because it's a fascinating story. It appears on the web. And the story goes like this, that a student was given in an exam the question, a physics exam, how would you use a barometer to measure the height of a very tall building? Okay? And the student answered something, Of course, the answer is, you know, you measure the pressure at the top, at the bottom, from the difference you can tell the height. The student gave some other answer, and he was failed. But he complained, and so this was given to another professor to check. And the professor met with the student and asked him, well, tell me some ways you think you could measure this. And the student gave him 10 different answers of how he would use the barometer to measure the salt. So the first was that he's going to drop the barometer from the roof of the building and measure how much time it takes to get to the ground. The second was that he will tie the barometer to a string, lower it from the roof, and measure the length of the string. The third was that he would hang the barometer on a string and use it as a pendulum and measure the period at the top of the building and at the bottom of the building, and from the difference in the free fall acceleration, he would tell the height. The fourth was that he would take the barometer and put it against the wall of the building and measure like this. And my favorite answer was that he will go to the custodian of the building and you tell him, look, I will give you this really nice barometer if you tell me the height of the building. Now, the professor, according to the story, asked the student, what, you don't know what answer they wanted? And he says, of course I know, but there is no reason for me to give you that particular answer. That story goes on to say, and this is very appropriate for a perimeter institute, that the name of the student was Niels Bohr. Now, this is again one of those apocryphal stories that is almost certainly not correct. But it demonstrates what I'm talking about. Okay? So that is my point. I want our education system, everything, to adopt methods that will actually encourage brilliant blunders. So basically, I'll finish by saying that scientific blunders, and by this I mean these brilliant blunders, can actually be the portals to discovery. Thank you very much.
That was terrific. Thank you. Yeah, you got it. Thank you. All right, let's open the floor to questions. And as you're preparing your question, I'm going to go to a question that popped into my brain. I guess it's the last lecture of the season, so I get to go first. I don't know how that works.
Go ahead.
The OPERA experiment, the faster-than-light neutrinos, they had data. They wrestled with it. They gave it to the greater scientific community to solve it. And it turned into be this scandal, where I read that as they did the process of science. So was that a brilliant blunder, a sloppy blunder? What do you think?
I think it was a sloppy blunder, and I'll tell you why. So this is an experiment that claimed a few years ago that they discovered neutrinos that move faster than light. Now, this is a result that was against evidence collected over 100 years. And by the way, I was asked, I gave an interview on NPR when that was discovered, and I said that if that turns out to be correct, I'm going to eat my hat, and that this is a stronger statement than the person who asked me thinks, because I don't actually own a hat, so I promise to buy a hat and eat it if that turns out to be correct. Why do I think it was not good? I think it would have been perfectly okay for those people to say, you know, after they look at all kinds of possibilities, we know that this result is probably wrong, but we don't understand why, and therefore we give it to the community to look at and so on. But what they did was that they immediately did a big press release. And so as a result of this, I regard this as a, you know, because at the end, you know what it turned out to be. It was the equivalent of something not properly plugged, you know. And there was a similar thing with when they claimed the discovery of bacteria that rely on arsenic instead of phosphorus in their DNA. That was an extremely sloppy experiment. So yeah, those were not brilliant.
Thank you.
Other questions?
Let's go in studio.
More of a story question than a science question, but if someone had suggested to Einstein the idea of an accelerating universe when he was taking out his cosmological constant, how outlandish of an idea was that? I know he adopted a lot of outlandish ideas in his time and definitely did write by them. But
yes, no, I'm not aware of anybody who at that time, remember that not even the expansion of the universe was discovered, let alone acceleration of it. And he still was really quite a prisoner of this idea that everything should be static. He was talking about stars instead of galaxies. So it really wasn't like that. I mean, it could have been, but it wasn't. But it's interesting that Newton actually once played a little bit with the idea of adding something that is a little bit like a cosmological constant in his equations.
Thank you.
Let's go to another in-house question.
Yes, hello. I would like to ask you about a possible candidate for your list of brilliant blunders here, namely the work of Max Planck. In 1895, I believe, Wien had discovered a law to describe the spectral distribution in a black body. And Max Planck was developing a theory of thermodynamics for radiation. That was his baby. Helmholtz had, not Helmholtz, but Holtzmann had previously, or Buchholz, I'm not sure which one now, had previously developed a theory of thermodynamics for solid bodies, and he wanted to do for radiation.
Well, statistical mechanics, yeah.
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 But he didn't like those methods of Boltzmann, those statistical mechanics. He was using Maxwell's equations and analogs of what was done in with kinetic, with gases. And so he managed to publish a proof using his theory of Wien's law around 1900. And about the same time, I guess people knew this, at the same time, experimental results came out to show that Wien's law did not hold for long wavelengths. And in that paper, they referred to the Planck-Wien law. And within
so you're asking, is that another example of a brilliant blunder? There are many like this.
Yeah. What happened, though, was that Planck went to work very hard. And he actually modified Wien's law and found a law that fit by guessing. And then he tried to give a theoretical proof, and his machinery did not work. So then he turned to the statistical mechanics, which he did not like, and found a proof. And in that proof, he quantized the energy levels, and it turned out that he was forced to choose H to be a certain specific value. It wasn't that he believed in it, it was a mathematical trick. And I thought having proved that incorrect result was a great motivation for him to try to save face.
Yes. And the history of science is really full of these types of things, you know, Dirac, when he predicted the positron, you know, I mean, he got a solution that nobody knew about. It wasn't clear whether it's a real solution, whether it corresponds to anything in the real world, and so on. Einstein himself, you know, did not. I actually toyed with the idea of saying that he was, you know, not a strong believer in quantum mechanics. Of course, we know that he was wrong in retrospect, but the questions that he raised actually were so fundamental that much of the work that is done at this institute actually deals with the question that raises, you know, about the foundations of quantum mechanics and so on. So history of science is full of this thing. But I told you how I chose my particular people. I'm sure I can write 7 other books that will all deal with various.
I would love to read them.
Thank you. Good. Let's in-house one more time.
In history, like over time, we as the human race, have accelerated in progress of learning new things, do you think that this could be because people have created more brilliant blunders and learned from mistakes?
Well, you know, the acceleration in the learning of humans is not attributable to a single factor. There are things, for example, in terms of, you know, we as humans developed more neurons in our cerebral cortex than all other primates. We can pack more in the same volume. So, you know, we have 86 billion neurons in our skulls. That gave us a big advantage over other primates. Then there are, you know, there are all these laws that describe of how technology develops, and those have accelerated a lot. We can solve today problems that we could never solve before because we have lots of large computers and things like that. We are developing artificial intelligence, which soon will perhaps solve problems that we can't even think of solving. You know, this is part. There are many reasons that accelerated things. I don't know that it is an increase in the rate of brilliant blunders that that caused the acceleration. But for sure, brilliant blunders played a role in some of the major breakthroughs. There is also serendipity, which also is important. You know, like people like to tell stories like Fleming discovering penicillin, things like that, which were discovered by accident. They were not exactly blunders. They were discovered by accident. So there is lots of accidental things that happened that also led to various breakthroughs.
All right, I'll take one question from the online, and then we'll finish with your question. So an online question. Do scientific breakthroughs typically come from lone geniuses working in isolation or by teams of scientists working in collaboration?
These things have changed over the history of science. I mean, it used to be more lone geniuses, but even the lone geniuses always relied on all kinds of work that was done before them. I mean, yes, there are a few people who stick out very high, you know, Galileo, Newton, and so on, Einstein, but even their work, you know, relies at the end on the work on people before them. So they didn't work in teams, but they did rely on some of the work before them. Today, we tend to work more in teams. I mean, experiments in particle physics today, like at the Large Hadron Collider, involve thousands of people that work on that. When Rutherford did his experiment at the beginning of the 20th century, it was him and an assistant. And that was an experiment supposedly in particle physics or nuclear physics, right? Today, you do an experiment, thousands of people are there. The discovery of the acceleration of the universe was actually done by two teams that include dozens of people in each one of the teams. At the end, you give the Nobel Prize to some of the leaders, but lots of people, you know, do the work. So I think we rely more on teamwork today than we used to, partly because the problems become harder and harder. Yeah.
Oh, thank you. And our last question in studio.
So when you were talking about how Hubble found that the universe was in fact accelerating, was there any more experimentation or...
It was expanding. He did not find it was accelerating.
Yeah, he found that it was expanding, sorry. Was there any more experimentation or theorization from the rest of the scientific community before Einstein basically changed his theory? Before he changed his theory to take out that term?
So Lemaître, who was a theorist, was not an observer. He actually showed, and before him there was somebody named Friedman who showed that there are solutions to Einstein's equations which involve expansion of the universe or contraction. Lemaître was so clever that he even showed that the existing observational evidence was consistent with an expansion. He was also a big fan of the cosmological constant, and he wanted to keep it in. He tried to convince Einstein to keep it in. But Einstein was so disappointed that he thought that he put in something that wasn't necessary that he actually refused. He said he refused to believe that nature would choose something so ugly to do. But the thing is, you see, that Einstein, as clever as he was, he was a little bit misguided here, because when he spoke about beauty or elegance, he thought that the beauty needs to be in the equation itself. And that's actually not true. What we find is that the beauty is in the principle behind this. The equation doesn't particularly need to be beautiful. It's the principle. And his general relativity allowed for this additional constant there. And that he should have realized that usually if the equations allow for that, then it's usually there.
Ladies and gentlemen, Dr. Mario Livio.